Please rise for the call to worship. The Word of Life spoke. The Word of Life reached out. The Word of Life walked out of death's dread tomb so that we could follow Him into life forever.
It's wonderful to welcome you to worship today, and I am so pleased to welcome back Reverend Caroline Unzaga, and I'm really happy to say that she joins us not today just as a guest preacher, but she is our new parish associate. So she is joining our church family, which is wonderful. She'll be assisting Pastor Tom with worship and preaching and pastoral care. She's also going to work with the deacons, which is just wonderful for them. So you can read more about Caroline, I think, in your bulletin and in eBless and the like, but I know we're going to all make her feel very welcome. This morning we celebrate communion. All who put their trust in Christ are welcome at the table. Elements will be distributed by the ushers. There's gluten-free bread in the middle. When you receive the bread and when you receive the cup, please hold on to them and we will partake of them together. I think you all know to look for the blue fellowship pads on the center aisle. Please sign in and pass them down. We love to know that you're with us this morning. A couple other things that I want to point out to you that are in your bulletin, but that are very important. One is that the church, led by Session, is hosting listening sessions. As you know, the church has recently gone through some changes, And the session wants to talk to the congregation about plans, and the session very much wants to hear from the congregation about what your thoughts are. These listening sessions are on April 18th, 21st, or 23rd. I think you can sign up on Sign Up Geniuses. Two of them will be in person, one after worship, one in the evening, and one will be a lunchtime Zoom. But for all of you in the sanctuary, all of you listening, maybe even all of you who watch this on Thursday afternoon, please sign up. Your feedback is very important to session. And then the other thing, I know we have just had the highlight of the Christian year with Easter, but I feel the highlight of the Presbyterian Church of Chatham Township year is the Youth Mission Trip Dinner. And that is always one of my favorite events. It's coming up in 3 weeks, Sunday evening, April 28th, from 5 to 7:30. Great food, fun, wonderful silent auction baskets that are so important that we support. Sending our youth out to serve needing communities is wonderful for them and wonderful for the world. So I really encourage you to sign up for the mission trip dinner. So now let us join our hearts and minds for the worship of God, and let us pray. God of new life, move through the locked doors of our hearts. Open us to your love moving in the world. Instruct us as you taught the disciples. Make a new church of us, a blessed place where we live in unity. Help us to learn from those first believers who also struggled to believe. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Friends, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But we hold on to this promise that if we profess our sin before God and before one another, we will be forgiven. Therefore, let us join our voices together and pray the prayer of confession printed in your bulletins. You have shown yourself to us, O God, by word and spirit, with signs and wonders, in flesh and blood, yet we struggle to live and believe the good news of Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us. Forgive us, enter into our lives, and cast out our fear, so that we may come to trust in you and have life in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, we have an advocate through Jesus Christ. He is the righteous one who offered his life and love for all of us. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome. Come join me up here. Good morning. I have some items here. And there is a man in the Bible by the name of Thomas. And I do think that sometimes Thomas gets a bad rap. How Thomas felt in the Bible is oftentimes how we may feel, where we doubt things. Mm-hmm. I want to do a little demonstration, if that's okay. Kate, do me a favor and grab that backpack. You're going to go on a journey, and you need this backpack to go on this journey. You're quite young, but you're going to go on the journey of life, okay? Nina, do me a favor, and I want you, you're going to help Kate go on this journey, and you're going to put some things that may come to her on this journey, things that may weigh her down. Why don't you grab the coin jar there? What does that jar say on the front? It says worry. Kate, on your journey, you are likely to worry about something. So we're going to put that in your backpack, okay? Can you go ahead and put that in your backpack? Do me a favor. Can you grab something else that's going to confront Kate on her journey?
Doubt.
You're going to doubt some things on your journey. So we're gonna put that in there too, Kate, okay? And let's see, can you grab something else that Kate's going to experience on her journey? Go ahead and pick something good.
Stress.
You're going to be stressed out a little bit in this journey called life, Kate. And so we're going to put that in there as well. And let's see, Nina, let's grab something else as if Kate doesn't have enough in life. Let's see what else she's going to have. You're going to fear some things, Kate, so we're going to stick that in there too. You know, we got to make sure you have that. And I think there's one more thing. Can someone grab something else that Kate will experience in life? You're going to get anxiety, especially with all this stress and fear and worry that you have in here. You're going to most likely have some anxiety, too. So all of this, Kate, let's try to fit it in here. And go ahead and stand up. Let's see. You're going to go on your journey. So let me just see, Kate, can you... You gotta walk in life. So are you gonna be able to walk with all this stuff? That's a lot. Do you think that you can make it to their destination like that? No? So Nina, one of the things, Kate, that God does for us is God says, we can't say that we won't experience anxiety, stress, fear, worry. Those things will happen in our life, right? But when we believe in God, this is what God does. God says, give those things to me. Let me take those on. And for you, I give you peace. I give you rest. So let's see if you can make it to the door with the pillow. A lot easier. Allow God to walk in our lives, to give us peace, and hand over those things that are burdens for us in our lives. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for who you are in our lives. Allow us to remember to turn those things over to you. For there are times that we may doubt your power, Lord God. Allow us to remember that we are to turn over those things that worry us, those things that stress us out, those things that bring us anxiety and fear. Allow us to look to you for comfort, for peace, for rest. We thank you for who you are and who you are in our lives when we truly believe in you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Yvonne. That was lovely. I think we will all take those words to heart today. Let us pray. Living God, With joy, we celebrate the presence of your risen word. Enliven our hearts by your Holy Spirit so that we may proclaim the good news of eternal and abundant life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our lesson from the New Testament today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 32 to 35. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need.
Oh, It's a pleasure to be with you this morning and to continue to see how the story unfolds after last week when Jesus' resurrection was announced. Please join me as we reflect on this reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. Listen now for the word of the Lord. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came, and he stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Friends, this is the word of the Lord, for which we say, thanks be to God. Well, it was a joy to begin my tenure here as parish associate this past Monday, April 1st, April Fool's Day, one day after Easter. I heard that the services were beautiful, that the sanctuary was packed, that the music was on point, the flowers were beautiful, and the proclamation, which is at the very heart of our faith, was right there, as always, reminding us, he is risen. He is risen indeed. But the reality of Easter is that while we proclaim from the mountaintops, when we get up early that morning and we gather together and we hear the trumpets and we say it as well, he is risen indeed. Even though we say that loudly, the reality on the ground is that the disciples were in a different place. We remember today and last week and during this season that good triumphs over evil, that life triumphs over death. Even with that profound truth, we know that not everybody was on the same page that week. That day, the disciples were in more of a valley than the mountaintop. In last week's text, we find them scared, so scared that they decided not to tell even one person. At least that's how Mark tells the story. Some of them certainly didn't believe yet, or they didn't know how to believe and how to proclaim if they did believe. And sometimes that mirrors our own reality, doesn't it? Even though we've heard the good news preached, even though we've heard that there is life after death, that evil doesn't have that final word, even when we've heard it, we're not in a place of rejoicing yet. And if that's where you are today, in your pews or joining from home, then this gospel reading is for you. Now, I'm going to start out by saying that if you are here in these pews, or even if you're tuning in at home, you're in the minority. I like to call it Faithful Remnant Sunday. That's not an indictment of you as a church. Even some of you came up to me before the service and said, don't judge us on this Sunday. It's a light attendance Sunday. But this is actually the case of every single church that I have ever served. A lot of times this Sunday is called Associate Pastor Sunday, or it really is, or Supply Preacher Sunday. It's that time when we have breaks going on with school, a lot of people are traveling, and we have a big turnout on Easter Sunday. It's at the heart of our faith. But then, like clockwork, the next Sunday, it's the lowest attendance numbers we get for the entire year. It makes sense, and I'm not here to judge. Pastors need time off after Holy Week and all the celebrations for that, so a lot of pastors take time off. Also, you all who have done a lot of cooking and cleaning and hosting families and friends and all the activities that happen, you might need a little bit of a break as well. Now, interestingly, during the pandemic, I marveled at how many people tuned in on Easter Sunday. It was numbers that were even higher than in person, and it was unbelievable. And I thought, while we were in lockdown in 2020, I thought, this year, it's going to be different. This year, we're going to break that trend, because people tuned in last week, and there's not that much going on around us. People have Wi-Fi. They figured it out last week. They'll come back again this Sunday. There's no traveling, by the way, if you remember. There's absolutely no traveling. And like clockwork, that Sunday after Easter, the numbers still plummeted, probably lower than they had ever been. Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. So who wants to stick around to see what happens later that night? Now, if you are here today, that's exactly what we are doing. We're tuning in and we're seeing what was happening later on that night with the disciples. John tells us that it was evening on that day, the first day of the week. Later that night, the disciples weren't out celebrating. They were behind closed doors. They were fearing for their lives, fearing the threat that existed outside, fearing that their fate might be the same of Jesus, the one who they had been following up to 3 days prior when he was crucified. If you are listening in right now, we are headed into the darkness of night, straight into a room full of fear. Now, you all may never have known what it was to hide for your lives before the pandemic, to shutter the doors, behind the doors, for the threat that existed outside. But we certainly got a crash course in that, didn't we, about 4 years ago. All of us got a crash course on what that extreme anxiety can do to us, that fear of a threat that exists outside. If we ever wanted to practice what we do with the reptilian response, that fight, flight, or freeze, that was the time, wasn't it? That was the time when we learned what trauma does to our minds and what it does to our bodies. One voice that spoke to me during that season, and she had been a prolific writer and pastor and preacher way before the pandemic, but Barbara Brown Taylor, who's an Episcopalian priest, wrote a book about 10 years ago called Learning to Walk in the Dark. And I revisited that book during that time to remind myself that, yes, we can do hard things even when it's dark outside. She wrote the book, and basically the premise of it was that we Christians like to live out in the light. We are people of the light. If you read our scriptures, it's all about the light. Jesus is the light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And it's also true, if you just think about biology and how things work, 50% of our lives is spent in the dark. We have day and we have night. We have summer and we have winter. And so we also, whether we like it or not, will experience dark. Now, in the book, every chapter, Barbara Brown Taylor set out on a different adventure to explore the dark. She went spelunking, which was exploring caves, actually with a Presbyterian pastor. She went to the museum exhibit in Atlanta, Georgia, the High, and she went to an exhibit that simulated what it was like to be blind. And she also wrote about her experience being a hospital chaplain when she did an internship. And when she was really forced to go into the darkest days of people's lives, as the medical crew went out, the chaplain would go in. And her task was to sit with those dark emotions, the sadness, the fear, the overwhelm of the moment. And what she found in these moments was that there were some lessons that you could only really learn in the dark. She said this, that she needs the dark just as much as she needs the light. What have you learned in the dark? I think that we're all kind of still processing this as we continue to build back from the pandemic. And now we're in a season where we're pretty much returning to normal, and yet we're all still exhausted. This is also the time that we can start to think about and reflect back on what it was like for us. What were some lessons that you had from that dark, dark period? For me, one thing that I got from the pandemic, just having been in the church and also in the hospital context, was that as much as I wanted to, I couldn't save everyone I wanted to save. And I couldn't control everyone I wanted to control. Maybe you bumped up against your own limitations as well. If we turn this question to the disciples today, as they hide in the dark of the night, the learning might be something like this. Even when you are in survival mode, even when you are in that darkest night of the soul, even when you don't completely believe what is being proclaimed outside, that Jesus is risen, even amidst the terror and the doubt, Jesus shows up and he offers us peace. Says it in our text, just check if you don't believe me. He shows up and he says it twice, peace be with you. And then he tells them to receive God's Spirit. In the darkness, there is light. And in the fear and doubt, there is still peace. The important question today is, what darkness are you encountering? It might be within you, it might be around you, it might be in your house, it might be in this church, it might be in our community, it might be in our world. What is the darkness that you encounter in this moment today? Where does your fear and your doubt lie? And then the next obvious question is, where is Jesus in all of that? How is Jesus showing up to you in the dark night of the soul? Don't let this question go. Hold on to it. What is the peace of Christ in those spaces? Can you hear Jesus speaking to you? Hear him speaking these words. He's saying them to all of us right now. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Receive God's Spirit. Have you seen the Lord in the darkness? Do you know his peace? If you don't yet, again, you're in good company. Took Thomas a full week to believe, and it was only after he had that firsthand experience, literally firsthand, touching Jesus' wounds, reaching out and touching him. But we are the recipients of these accounts. We see the examples of how hard it is to believe. And we also see that Jesus shows up even to those who doubt. He shows up and he shares his peace in the darkest of nights. Friends, if you have felt the calm amidst the storm, you know that this peace is one that passes all understanding. If you have felt that peace, you know that in a world full of scarcity, in a world that is full of fear, that peace still has no end. It comes from a source bigger than us, thank God. And it arrives when we are tapped out just in time. In the early morning and later that night too, Jesus shows up in the light and he shows up in the dark as well. Speaking into our lives, peace be with you. Peace shows up for all of us, even later that night. In the name of the one who was and is to come, amen.
Please rise for the affirmation of faith. We'll be using the Apostles' Creed, and you'll find it in your bulletin. We believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. We believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Before we enter into our time of prayer, I'd like to share specific prayers that were requested. For Herb Reichlin, father of Evan Skinner, who has recently entered hospice care. For Joey, grandson of a close friend of Pamela Fairley, dealing with complications after a liver transplant. And Gwen Hauser, mother of Sam Eckert, who fell recently and is recovering from hip surgery. Prayers for Sam as she cares for her mom. Now, please join your hearts and mine with mine as we go to God in prayer. Let us pray. God, creator of all things, redeemer of all things, one who sustains all of us in the day and in the night. We give you praise today because you are eternally victorious over death. In faithfulness, you have raised up Christ for us, and your mercy knows no end. God of life, we pray that those who are bowed down under the weight of hunger, injustice, uncertainty, or despair, that you would be with them. You who provide every good thing, uphold your people. Open your hands wide and satisfy the needs of every living thing. God of hope, we trust in your righteousness and we depend on your love. Be near to those on whose behalf we call upon you, to those who face sorrow, illness, injury, or death. Fulfill our longings for wholeness, healing, and new life. Hear and answer all who cry out to you. Steadfast God, preserve us in your love, that we might speak your praise and bless you forever. In the name of the Holy One, the risen Christ, who teaches us to pray as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we prepare to receive this morning's offering, let us remember the first believers who shared one heart and soul, held their possessions in common, and distributed them to all in need. In that same spirit, let us present our gifts to the risen Lord. Let us now have the offering.
Thank you.
us pray. Eternal God, take and use these gifts for your purpose in the world, giving food to the hungry, hope to the despairing, and new life to the dead. Teach us to live each day for you so that future generations will know your goodness and praise your glory. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Friends, blessed are you who hunger for righteousness, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are those who yearn for righteousness, for you will drink deeply of the cup of joy. Blessed are you who yearn for reconciliation, for you will find peace. Blessed are you who are persecuted in the name of religion, for yours is the commonwealth of heaven. Blessed are you and all of we, for Christ calls us to his table, where there is room for everyone and plenty for all. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
In the name of the Lord, let us pray. In every time and every age, O God, people have given thanks, for your mercy is sure and your steadfast love endures forever. In your compassion, you gave us Christ Jesus, who sets us free from death and leads us to life eternal. And so with all creation, with all the needy and hungry ones, with all those who have enough and plenty, with creatures large and small, with sun and moon and stars, with the saints of every age, we praise your name. In your power and love, you continue to deliver your people from bondage, to thwart the designs of evil, to show the way through the wilderness, to turn hardship into righteousness, and to reveal your hand upholding the just. We praise you, O Christ, servant of the universe. You came among us to feed and heal and teach, to confound the haughty, to confuse the deceivers, to challenge the wrong-hearted, and in all these things, to give hope to those who long for peace. Come now, O Prince of Peace, Spirit of Love, Breath of Life. Bring to all this hurting world the joy that Mary knew, and teach us to proclaim with her, I have seen the Lord. In gratitude for this great day, in remembrance of the resurrection, we praise you, God of all that is, now and forever.
Amen. Friends, the story at the heart of our faith is this, that Jesus, on his last night, gathered with his friends, the disciples, and he took the bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Whenever you eat of this, do so in remembrance of me." In like manner, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant by my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Every time that you drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me." So that, friends, every time that we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again, and come again he shall. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Amen.
it again. Yeah. They figured it out. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. No. We'll take them back. Sorry.
The cup of salvation.
Thank you all for your patience. Let us pray. Living Christ, as you open the scriptures to us, make yourself known in the breaking of the bread. Let us now go forth from this place, fed at your table, filled by the Spirit, to walk with you all the days of our lives. Proclaim the glory of your resurrection to all the world. Amen. Amen.
This encouragement for all of us today. Whether you are basking in the glow of Easter morning or you find yourself more like the disciples in the darkness shuttered behind doors later that night, no matter where you are, Christ appears with us and shares his peace. We are not alone. Now receive this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.